This is AA Beyond Belief, episode 130. I met Douglas at my home group, We Agnostics, and last summer, after a meeting, we were talking about recovery-related movies as topics for future podcasts, and he suggested The Way Out, a short film by Jim Greco. Douglas has been skateboarding his entire life, and Jim Greco is a professional skateboarder who made this film about his 11th and 12th year of sobriety. This sounded like an intriguing idea, so I asked Douglas if he would do the podcast with me. A few weeks later, we watched the film together and recorded the podcast you're about to hear. It's an interesting conversation, not only about the film, but about Douglas and his recovery, skateboarding culture, and learning to enjoy activities sober that in the past may have been opportunities for drinking. What is it that you like about that movie that we can talk about?
For me, being someone that has skated for the last 20 years, seeing a professional skateboarder make a personal movie about their way out of addiction. He struggled with all sorts of alcohol and heroin and all sorts of other stuff, and just seeing what his life's like now, 12 years, not exactly free of addiction, but of what his life is like now in recovery. And for me, that was just inspiring and just kind of something to kind of model off of. I want to say I watched it after I started getting sober, but I was kind of a chronic relapser. So even in times that I was still out drinking, I knew that was always there, and I could always go back and like watch that and still remind myself, you know what you want, you know you want to like seek recovery again. How do you get there? And that it was just kind of a tool and constantly a, you know, an inspiration button. I knew where to go and click on it.
So is drinking and drugging part of the skateboarding culture?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Just kind of comes, I mean, it was part of the old surfer culture. It's just it's kind of part of just let loose and you're hanging out. And it's kind of a young man's culture, and drinking and drugging and sex and rock and roll, like just kind of all come with that. There are a handful in it that have never drank or touched a drug in their life. They're far and few between. Some have been able to, you know, kind of watch it happen to other people and know how to kind of like not go down that rabbit hole too bad. And then some, they end up getting down it in some way, shape, or form. And it's just real, it's real popular for the cycle to be like go out and skate and accomplish something and then party. And you party about what you accomplished and just party with your friends and go out and see shows, go see music, like pick up girls, like whatever. It just kind of comes with that like go, go, go. It's euphoria. Like let's just keep the party going.
Was Jim Greco one of the first professional skateboarders who came out publicly with his recovery?
No. I have no clue who would be the first. Definitely one of the first that I've seen that's ever made a video like that. There's been guys and girls that have talked about it in interviews. There have definitely been a lot that have kind of lost their position as a professional because of it.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Wonder why.
You kind of stop showing up and you stop doing your job. I know that was kind of sarcastic.
Is it because when they got clean, they couldn't skateboard?
No. I mean, like they lost their job while they were using. Like, I see. There's a lot of people that use and can still keep their position as a professional skateboarder. But then there are some that have climbed so far down to where, you know, they're basically not even skating anymore. Okay. They're not doing their job anymore. And at the end of the day, when you're sponsored to skate, your job is to skate. Gotcha. It's to, you know, promote these different companies and to show up for different things and
See, I'm so ignorant of professional skateboarding.
Yeah.
So there are actually people that are making a living.
Yeah. He's someone right. that has yeah. been making a living through sponsorships, and a big part, especially in his like coming up and till more recently, like the two biggest ways to make a living in skateboarding is filming video parts and competitions. And for a lot of skateboarding since the 90s and into the 2000s, video parts pretty much outweighed everything. Because that's when street skateboarding became more of the, you know, it's just more of what everybody did. It became more popular. And there's a lot of people in skateboarding that they don't like to compete. And I'm one of them. I'm not competitive with most people. And a lot of us are just kind of competitive with ourselves for right. the most part. And we just, a lot of us like have weird social anxieties. So like being one person in front of all these people, then, hey, monkey, go do tricks. Right. Like, blah, that's yeah. just, a lot of us don't like that. So just being able to, like most of that film, from just what I can see, it's like a small group of people going out and filming and skating right. together. I personally like that in almost everything I do. I like to be by myself, or I like to be in a small group. I can stand big crowds, but I don't always like it. And it can yeah. be just overstimulating and overwhelming. I like having – it feels more kind of intimate to be – like, you see that with him and his friend. I don't know that other guy's name, and I probably should, because I imagine he's a very influential pro skateboarder, and I'm bad about not knowing every pro skateboarder, because at the end of the day, I don't give a fuck.
Right.
Like, I'm not one of those people that I don't know all the actors in the right. world. I don't pay attention to...
My wife,
to,
she knows the name of every single actor and every single movie.
Yeah, that's cool. But if they did it like really stick out to me yet, right. and a keyword yet,
yeah,
they didn't stick out, and I haven't right. bothered to like really get to know who they are and how they've influenced stuff. But you kind of see that between them, and just how... watching each other like battle through for tricks and just kind of spend the day together. You mm-hmm. can see the emotions on their face and just how they share that experience together. It's a very intimate
yeah.
thing. And it's a very big part of what people talk about. Not exactly in those words, but just hanging out with friends and sharing like the experience. And it's not all about like the hardest trick you can do. 'Cause a lot of it's more just being around the people you want to be around and doing things that you like to do, and not necessarily like trying to measure that all the time. So you get to see that
when
with
you
them.
Skate, is it mostly on your own?
It's a bit of both. Here lately, it's been a lot on my own.
Uh-huh.
And growing up, it was a lot on my own, because I grew up in some different places that didn't have like a high concentration of other skaters. Or definitely not in my age group. So some of my best like time skating have been by myself. Sometimes that's when I've learned like the most amount of stuff, is when I've just been by myself. And sometimes it can be a very individual thing. And like there have been times where being at like skate parks and people like are going there more to hang out, which right. that's fine. And they're like wanting me to talk and stuff. And I'm like, no, today I came here to skate. Like, hi, but I'm focused right now. It's like nothing against them, but like I kind of get focused, and I don't, when I sit down and stop for 5 minutes, I'm like pretty much done for the rest of the day. So it's like go, 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 go. And then like, then if I finally sit down, I'm like, okay, like I'm done. So I just once that ball gets rolling, I try to like keep it going. So it took a while until I was like honestly like 18 is when I found, like I had, when I was younger, it would just be like one or two other people that I found that I could like really skate with, and kind of had the more of a similar mentality about it, and just like were as driven and passionate about it as me. But it wasn't until I was about 18 and I came to like Kansas City North versus kind of being in the more outstretched like rural areas of Kansas City, that I found like a group of like 5 to 8 guys mm-hmm. that like regularly got together and went skating and like came to downtown Kansas City and like skated downtown and midtown and all that stuff. And to me, like, that was all downtown until right. I met downtown people that were like, no, that's downtown, that's midtown, that's right, this, right, that's Briarcliff, right, yeah, that's or right, that's right. this is whatever. And like, that to me, I grew up north of the river,
right?
Everything south of the river is downtown. Exactly. that's I don't know, that's been my experience of how people kind of view it up there. But once I got down here, it exposed me to really how tight knit like the skate scene is here in Kansas really? City. And I knew about Escapist Skateboarding because I've been shopping there since I was like 7. And they used to be up off of Berry and North Oak.
Okay.
So I could get my parents to go there like twice a year, birthdays and like Christmas-ish time. I could get them to take me to like Kansas City North and go there. And then they, you know, got a little bit more popular and started opening up shops in different places. And I don't remember what year it was, but they opened up one at Southwest Boulevard and Broadway, basically. And so that kind of...
I remember that. I know that.
You remember
place.
When it yeah. kind of uh-huh. when it showed up? Yeah, yeah. It used to be like I want to say it was like a motorcycle shop. Uh-huh. And been one for like a long time. Yeah. And then finally it stopped being one. And now it's a skate shop and kind of like art gallery type thing. So then once they kind of like... That became kind of their center of everything. And then it gave them space with kind of the space to the side of it to be an art gallery. It gave them a way, and with First Fridays that happen downtown, it gave them kind of this space to open up and share skateboarding with more people and the public, and kind of invite people that maybe didn't know anything about skateboarding, but maybe know something about art or just like art or just like, ooh, hey, shiny, I'm going to walk in here. And so it just kind of... It just helped more. And they've always been really great about bringing in outside companies that are like on skate tours and having demos. And they used to do that. They would have a lot of demos up at Pleasant Valley Park. I grew up going to that park, and like I remember going to a couple of those. And then now that Penn Valley's here, which is at like 31st and Penn, it's like right next to Penn Valley College. And now that that's there, and it's more of kind of like a modernized skate park.
So most actually, of them is it actually there. A skate park that has all the concrete stuff yeah. where you can actually
yeah,
it's actually built for skateboarding.
Yeah, it's explicitly built for like skateboarding, and you could say BMX, but some uh-huh. skaters would argue that. And same with like scooters or inline, but right. it's a public park meant for extreme sports.
Where's that at?
It's right there by Penn Valley. Do you know the Indian that's at the
yeah,
Penn Valley Park?
Yeah.
It's there. There's like tennis courts, the Indians oh, like I'll at the north part. There's the huge condo lofts.
Yeah, I know.
And
exactly
smacked
what
like
about.
In the middle of it exactly is a skate park. About. Yeah. Okay. When that skate park got lights, that condo building hated oh. them and threw a big old fit and did not want them to have that. But yeah, it's skate parks are a mix of like these kind of obstacles that would basically be used for nothing else but skateboarding, and then like an adaption of what you would find in like common street areas or like plazas and like stair sets and handrails and like kind of almost art looking sculpture like things. And we look at it and go, I can skate that.
Right.
Like, that's no longer like something that I just walk up and down. That's not uh-huh. something that supports me to walk up right. and down. That's like this obstacle I can jump over or on or ride and whatever. And that's part of what like a lot of us love so much is just this ability to use things for not what they were meant for.
Right.
And that's where some of the creative process comes from. And that's, I don't know. And to me, that's like, that fuels like the addiction for it. Like I can no longer look at like beer ads. I can no longer look at certain things and not think of my addiction. I can no longer look at a set of stairs and not think of skateboarding. Like, right. it's just, it's changed my perception of the world around me.
when you go to a skate park like that, what's the age range of the people that are skateboarding?
Oh, man, from 3 years old to older than you.
Older than me. That's pretty incredible.
There's a YouTube video of, I want to say the guy was in his 70s.
Wow.
And he was just learning.
Oh, my God.
Never been on a skateboard ever in his life. Was just learning to skate at like 70.
Oh, wow. That's funny.
It's honestly, I mean, the core age is, you know, probably 10, 11, 12 to low 20s. But then now it's becoming more common. Guys that grew up in the 90s, I mean, we're about to turn 30. So it's becoming an even bigger group of people that do. But like, yeah, the core of it, I mean, it's kind of a brutal quote sport.
Yeah.
it's a brutal lifestyle. It kind of hurts, and it's not for everybody. And some people eventually, you know, kind of hang up the board and move on to just different stuff. And then some people like myself can just not imagine life without it.
Right. So do you think that Jim Greco's skateboarding suffered from his using, and did it get better when he quit?
I think it's a mix of both. I think there's a sense of, in a way, it could help it, or it can help you. It can help you deal with how bad it hurts.
Right.
That was especially my,
I was wondering about
experience
that.
With it.
Whether it be alcohol or drugs,
yeah,
I guess.
It helped you kind of dull the pain of a really hard day, of whether you just are worn out, or like you slammed a lot and you ache, or like you break shit, like, and then potentially you're getting like prescriptions from hospital, or you tear stuff, which I've done.
Right.
Like you get prescriptions from hospitals and you start kind of going down that avenue.
Isn't that interesting that I'm drinking to dull the pain? Because that's pretty much what we all do anyway,
mm-hmm.
whether it be emotional pain or
physical. And a lot of people, and for myself and a lot of people that I've encountered in skateboarding, we come from kind of nasty backgrounds and not so great, like family lives. So skateboarding was our escape. And that is for like a lot of people, between just kind of like being in rough, bad neighborhoods and trying to get out of like gang life, to just trying to get away from like abusive or just absent parents, to just, you know, or they're just weird and they don't fit in to these other like social norm groups. But you can be weird and not fit in
right.
with skateboarding, and it's kind of
makes sense too, because it's something you can do in the city and it's not that expensive, is it? You can just get a
it is and it isn't
yeah.
People, like, it is kind of expensive, but like as a kid I did BMX too, and a bike can cost almost as much as
yeah.
freaking motor, like a motorcycle
yeah.
sometimes, like, or I really like dirt bikes and four wheelers. I would love to be able to like race those.
Mm-hmm.
That's mm-hmm. super intriguing to me. My family did not have that money, but I could get them to go spend like $150 on like a brand new setup. And then just try to make that last as long as possible. And then that's when it helps, when you have like that other like kind of core group of friends, because then like maybe they're a little better off and they could get something. Or what I was kind of talking about earlier with like, I don't like focusing or snapping old boards, because someone at the end of the day probably has a worse board or no board. And they could use your old stuff. Like, I had lost my board, and my friend just had like all this old hardware in his closet, his old wheels and trucks and bearings and all this like stuff that he's been stacking up for the last like decade, literally like the last 10 years worth of just old crap. And it wasn't great, but all I had to do was go get a board, and then voila, the rest of my setup was there. It wasn't great, but I could skate and I could work with it. And like, I don't know, when you see some kids and what they're skating, and then like what they can do on what they're skating, you like, you almost want to give them like a
right,
brand
yeah,
new board and be
yeah.
like, I can see how passionate you are, like, here, like, skate this, and then just like watch things like develop from there. But it's just, I would say it's cheaper than it's cheaper than being like in elementary school and needing to be on like a private soccer team.
Sure.
Or like basketball team or something, between gear and just what it costs to be in the classes and all that stuff, which there are now like kind of training programs to do. But at the end of the day, like, all you really need is you and a skateboard and your front driveway or sidewalk, just a little patch of concrete, and you can, your garage floor, where a lot of us have done, learned a whole bunch of stuff, because it's the one place in the middle of Midwestern winter, January, that we can go and play around. Like, right. You don't really have any space, but it's just enough, or like your basement, it's just enough, or carpet skateboarding, it's just enough to like feed that bug inside you that like, I want to do this. And so, I mean, it's not cheap, but it's kind of like with anything, if it's what you want, you have to kind of sacrifice other stuff. Like, when I started skating, I didn't want anything else. Like, I wasn't really asking for anything else. It was, no, I need another pair of skate shoes. No, I need, like, another deck. I need another this, like, to progress the skating. It wasn't, all my cousins had all these, like, Legos and G.I. Joes and stuff. I didn't care. I mean, they were cool. I liked going to their houses and played with that stuff. But at the end of the day, like, no, my skateboard was, like, the one and only toy that I really, really, really wanted and needed.
So you know how some people talk about, like, they did something when they were drinking. For example, they were golfing, mm-hmm. and they always drank, or mm-hmm. if they ever went out to a game, or so. Did you have that association?
I'm glad you bring this up, because it totally hit. The last time I was in the hospital and I talked about skateboarding being like a great coping tool, but it's, for me, it's a double edged sword. Because drinking and like weed and other drug use is heavily associated with it. And it's just around that culture. And most of the people I skated with, I'd smoked a lot of weed with, and that was normal. So it was kind of a, like, this last time I got out of detox, it took me, I want to say it was almost a month till I actually went out and skated.
Wow.
Which, since the last time I had skated before that, in my using, I wasn't skating at all. So it had been like almost 5 months since I had really stepped on a board and like did anything.
How'd that feel?
Rusty. Rusty. There are some things I can do. No matter, it's like jumping back on a bike and I can like do these certain things. But it's still, you can feel like the lack of control you used to have, and like, I'm just now getting it back. I had a session the other night that I really tapped into that zone, that it felt really good, and I was like learning new things, and I could really feel that, like, it will never go away from my brain. Like, I'll always know how to do these things. Like,
right.
I know how to do it, but to have my body be like trained for it and be in like conditioned to do it is a totally different story. And that, like, argument between what I know I can do and what my body can do at that point in time is always, like, this weird kind of, like, thing.
But it wasn't that difficult to get back to it sober?
No. No, if shit, it's... And that's what it kind of goes back to, like, do you think it hindered it? In a way, it's... If you can get past, like, my certain mind blocks, it's, to me, it's easier. And at the end of the day, like, with the hindering or helping, like...
What do you mean by the mind blocks? Is it like the inhibitions of being the fear, maybe, of a certain...
It can be the fear, like with the social anxiety type aspect of it, like drinking or drugging can kind of help with that side of stuff. Someone has talked about like doing their artwork, and they did their artwork fucked up. They felt like they were more creative when they were like that.
Right.
And well, there's a creative aspect to skateboarding. So you're so used to doing it in this type of mindset that now coming into it from a sober stance, like, you feel like you might not be able to, or just now you're in these places with people you used at or used with, and now like you're kind of different. So that might be like running around in your brain. But I think it's, like, before, if you were using it to kind of like dull the pain, it would do it, but it wasn't helping heal you at all.
Right.
It was just honestly hurting you more. And if you're sober and you start to use techniques to dull the pain without drugs, like, I started, instead of taking a shower and having shower beers, I started taking baths with Epsom salt. And so similar, but one that's like, ooh, a hot shower feels good, beer to help all the pain. Or I can take a nice hot bath with Epsom salt and actually like relax and heal my muscles and like drink water and not beer. So what's dehydrate myself or what's hydrate myself? Imagine which one's actually like helping my body heal itself. Yeah. Which one will actually make me feel better in the long run? So that's where I think if you're like being sober, you're not going out all day hurting yourself and then staying out all night hurting yourself some more. Whereas I go out and I kind of, and I potentially don't get hurt. There are a lot of sessions that I don't get hurt on. And then there are sessions that's all I do.
Right.
It's just kind of, it comes
well,
with the territory.
Well, you don't wear pads or helmet or anything like that.
No, you learned how to fall.
Right. Yeah, I saw him do that, Jim Greco in that film.
Yeah.
He did a lot. He made a few falls. And
And that's definitely not showing all his falls.
Yeah.
And that's another thing of like the outside public and seeing. When they do see skateboarding, they usually see it in this, and it even messes with skateboarders, like, because we watch a video part and most of a video part is going to be roughly 90% success.
Right.
And you throw in a few falls in there because there's some shock value to it. But if you saw all the like back footage to get each of those clips, like some of those takes are first try, first go, bam, you got it. And some of those are 100, 200 takes later.
Wow.
Some of those are 3 days worth of going back and forth trying to like get that thing.
That's amazing. You know, when you watch something like that, I'm not thinking about what actually goes into making it.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's potentially on what
it shows you how good it is.
Yeah. Yeah. And it makes it look easy. And that also just shows, you know, like how long they've been doing it to make themselves look that natural and honestly a very unnatural thing to be riding around on a piece of wood that is not natural at all.
Yeah.
But some of these people can make it look like they're
is very graceful. He was very graceful in that. I can see the artistic value in it, just the way that he moved and the way that he could just look at some object and figure out what he was going to do with it.
Mm-hmm. And usually that's kind of what like inspires you, like the object inspires you to do something different. And it's just, I mean, yeah, that's where the creative side comes from. And I've always looked at it like dancing. I look at it as I think you're dancing on a piece of wood. That's kind of how I've always looked at it. And I always wanted to dance and just was too scared to ever do that. And I found this other thing. It was like, oh, this is a little bit more socially acceptable that I liked it. And I've kind of run internal and chunky. And it fed all these different needs for me. But yeah, touching kind of back on the, you think you're like better sober. I definitely think so. I mean, different people could argue this, but like, I remember even when I got high regularly, that there would be times where like, oh, I'm too high. Like I'm not able to skate like how I want to skate. And then there's sometimes like it's the right strain. And it's like, ooh, I'm just the right high. This is great. And then like I would get completely sober and I'd be skating and I'd be kind of going through that rusty period of like, fuck, it's been a little while since I've skated and like I'm trying to get it back and I'm conditioning myself again and kind of what we call getting our skater legs, just kind of getting them back into shape. And once you do that, like it's kind of fine. And then I started kind of dabbling with smoking again. And like I would smoke and be like, oh fuck. Yeah. I don't know how I skated like this. Like I can't do this. Like I could roll around, but like I can't trust myself, basically. I can't, and I really need to have, like, confidence and trust in my ability, because if I need to, like, bail and get out of it, like, I need every little, like, cat-like reflex I have in me to try to get away from it, like, and not get hurt. And it just kind of anymore, and that's why, like, I know a lot of dudes that do get pretty drunk when they skate. I always save getting drunk for after, because I didn't like being I didn't mind being, you know, that like just fine line a few in me and skating, but I didn't want to lose any of those like reflexes that I desperately knew I needed to keep from. My big thing is basically anything can hit the ground but my head.
Right.
That's the one thing that like I make sure does not hit the ground, and it still has, but not that many times. So I just, yeah, I would save my heavy drinking for after. And with my type of drinking also, I was a shut-in drunk. So usually, like, when I was really getting into drinking, I wasn't doing anything. I wasn't skating. I just wasn't doing anything. I slept in my bed and slept for 20 hours. And the only time I got up was for a meal and to go get more. And that's another reason why, kind of leading back to the, like, is it a being a double-edged sword and does it trigger you wanting to drink? It does and it doesn't. Because of that, like, because I'm more of a shut-in drunk, not all of my skating is associated with it, but some of it is, or a lot of it's more, I don't feel like getting drunk while I'm skating, but when I go home and I'm by myself again and I'm hurt and I'm sore, that's when I start to, like, think, beer sounds real good, or, like, some Jim Beam sounds real good.
That makes sense.
But for me, I've never been that outrageous, like, big partier. Mm-hmm. That was never attractive to me. I'm kind of loud and obnoxious, but competing with other loud and obnoxious people, I guess I don't like it. I don't know. I've just not been super attracted to that.
I was kind of a solitary drinker. It was kind of odd, though. I would start drinking. I would drink in bars. But I was pretty much by myself.
While you were there.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's when I have drank in bars. I've either been with like one friend that I really liked and we were there to like play pool or do whatever. Or yeah, I was like, I would happen to be drinking by myself. Or when I was driving a semi, I started doing that a little bit more because that was the only place I really could drink while I was out there. And it was kind of fun to be in a different state, different city, and just sit at a bar and be like, oh, is this any different? Oh, no, not really. Like, yeah. It really wasn't. But it was still kind of interesting to do. So yeah, it's all the same, and it's not at all at the same time. And it just makes it where I can still go on trips with friends that use and whatever. But it's just, I try to, I've been on trips where there's enough people to have two cars, and there's the smoking car and the non-smoking car.
Yeah.
Are these usually
trips for skateboarding trips? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. You literally like go drive to the other side of Kansas to go find like this one to go to this one skate park and skate there all day. Like we'll take that three and a half, 4 hour trip out to Wichita.
Yeah.
And go skate Wichita, and then there's Derby Park, and there's a couple others, uh-huh. and then you potentially like street skate and. Yeah, that's you take mini, depending on how much time you have, you take mini vacations. Like, and that's been my thing is like ever since a little kid, like people talk about going on vacations. I can never not think about taking my skateboard on a vacation.
Yeah.
Sure. Like people are like, oh, I want to go see the sights. Going and seeing the sights for me is like
this. Skateboard
like,
on the sights.
Yeah, I want to skateboard on the sights. Like. It's something that, like, is so pretty that I can skateboard. And that could be the mountains. Like, I've seen people with, like, desert mountains that, like, I'm skating on them. And they look like they should be skated. They look like these waves that have just been cut out into the earth. And it's like, yeah, I want to play on that. That looks awesome.
That's funny.
And I don't know. That's just, again, that's just where it's kind of warped my perception. And just, like, that's part of vacation to me is doing something that I enjoy and like that's what would get me to the other side of the country or the other side of the world is the drive to want to skate something else, to see something else and to skate it. And then with it comes like you see in the video, not all of them is like trying to like accomplish these like hard tricks. Some of them is just like him skating, like just skating down the road and like skating through. And you see a lot, they showcase in that a lot of hard LA life of like tent cities down the street and like these different things. And that's one of the greatest things about skating. And then when you go to other places in skating, you're going just fast enough to see a lot of stuff, but just slow enough to really kind of like look around and see it and kind of take it in a little bit more. I feel the same way with like riding a bike around, like whether that be a road bike or a BMX bike or whatever. You're going just fast enough to like get to the other side of the city. But just slow enough to really...
You can pretty well on a skateboard, can't you?
You can. Like, half of the time, I'm as fast as the buses.
Wow.
Like, just because they stop a lot.
Sure.
And I don't.
Right.
And definitely if it's more short distance, because how I skate is like a sprint more than like kind of a long thing. But, you know, the more you get your conditioning back and stuff, like, there have been times where I've went to go donate plasma and blood. And my heart rate's almost too low they're freaking out. And they're like, wait, are you athletic? I'm like, yeah, I skate every day. I like ride bikes and stuff. They're like, oh, okay. Your heart rate's like 41. You're freaking out. I was like, no, I'm just okay. Like, I'm fine. I'm relaxed. And like, I'm not worried about anything. Just my heart rate stays low. It doesn't have to work that hard. So skateboarding is super, super physical and like physical throughout the entire body. And it just, it's one hell of a cardio workout. So if you want to lose some weight, go skate some trails.
I do need to lose some weight. I don't know if skateboard
will. And there's safe ways to skateboard. You can just like skate some walking trails and
It's funny. I've never been an adrenaline junkie.
Yeah.
I do like the things I used to like to do were running and bike riding.
It's, you get some of that more of the not just the adrenaline, but just the runner's high. That endorphin release.
Yes, you get those endorphin release. You absolutely do.
And that comes from it. It doesn't have to be like.
I don't like that feeling of being on a roller coaster where you're like falling or you're.
You don't get that. Well, okay, depending on what, if you're jumping down like big sets of stairs or you're like airing like out of stuff, like you get
Jim
that falling.
Greco was jumping over the roof.
That gives you that sense of falling. And I also just like the sense of like, I really like skating down really big hills and we call it bombing hills. And that you're like teeter tottering on this edge of making it or crashing. And that adrenaline of coming from, well, I almost just ate the ground, but I didn't. That like feeling of accomplishment and just kind of the adrenaline of like knowing like that would have really hurt, but I didn't have to go through it. So that you like feel, you just get overcome with adrenaline and endorphins and all this other stuff. It just that feels really good. But I've also used that to self-harm. I've been in like bad emotional states and instead of like cutting myself or something, I go find the biggest, fattest hill I can and push mad at it. And well, if I make it, I make it. If I don't, cool. Cause I get to like focus this like pain physically somewhere because I'm feeling all this other stuff. And I found some other people in like the skateboarding community that have like, dude, I know what you're talking about. And we've had like conversations about using it to self-harm. And again, that just kind of comes back to where it can be.
Is that a form of escape? The self harm? Is that almost like drugging and drinking?
I think so. Cause it gives you a way to focus it on something. Like, cause even when you're drunk, you're kind of like, I never was able to really get rid of the
Unfortunately,
pain.
Unfortunately, sometimes you just kind of,
it just focuses the pain in this different way. And it's still, it's just focused not off of, on whatever. It's just focused on like my drunk pain now.
Right.
And I think it helps you focus onto one thing or the other instead of what's like you're potentially running from. And that's more my experience. And I haven't had a lot of like self-harm type.
No.
Not things that I would have considered self-harm at the time, but now I realize like different actions. I'm like, ooh, yeah, that definitely was. I'm very, have a habit of self-sabotaging and stuff like that.
I think it's interesting that that on one hand, skateboarding is very healthy. It's something that you enjoy, and I think it's important to have a passion in your life like that. Mm-hmm. Especially, it's great that, I mean, if we're going to be clean and sober, we may as well enjoy our life, right?
Yeah. Otherwise, why are we doing it?
Exactly. But at the same time, you also recognize it as part of your addiction. So it's like you understand that you have to figure out a way to do it in a healthy way, I guess,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, to balance the two.
Yeah,
for me, like, and to touch lightly on, like, what I think a drug is, to me, and from any research I've done, a drug is a mind-altering substance, and to me, everything alters your mind. Yeah. So there's, you can, everything and nothing can be, like, very healthy and very, like, self-abuse all at the same time, and there's just finding that happy medium with it, like, and it's definitely, it's way easier to, like, use drugs to, like, fall off the deep end, and but, like, you can use a lot of other stuff to escape responsibilities and how you feel and all that stuff, too, and still be harming yourself. It might not be as fast.
Right.
I mean, alcohol is really not that fast as heroin or other things, but it's still faster than, like, a lot of other methods to do that with.
So do you know any other skateboarders that are in recovery in Kansas City?
Personally, yeah, actually, a handful, and then some that I didn't know that were, that are older, and recently, I was telling you about that, Over It article that Thrasher put out. They had had it physically in their magazine, and I picked up that magazine, then later on, I was, like, looking at their website, and they had posted the same article onto, like, their website feed, onto their blog feed, or whatever you call that. And so then I shared it on my Facebook. And from there, someone that I just more of an acquaintance in skateboarding in the city that I know, you know, was like, oh, that was a really good article. Like, I've been clean for I don't even remember how long or whatever, but just like, I'll never go back. I like, and just kind of shared a little bit of that. And I was like, oh, I mean, I didn't know him as a partier necessarily, but I didn't know he was explicitly sober either, and had been through the, like, been in the program or through the program or whatever. And then I've had friends that I've kind of, I feel like the seed has been planted potentially in other places in their life, and then being close with me has planted a seed, and they've come to me and just kind of asked me about, you know, what my experience has been and what I think and stuff like that. And, like, I'm very open about it. I don't really care. I'm not ashamed by it at all. And I'm glad to, like, if they have questions, I'm more than happy to like, kind of know what my viewpoint is on it. And none of them to this day are sober at this moment, but I know the seed's planted.
Right.
And I know they're, you know, kind of, I know they're looking at what they're doing, and I know they're questioning, you know, where they're at with it. And fuck, like, when one friend came to me, like, it made me extremely happy and sad, because I was like, damn it, like, I thought, was really hoping you were, like, teetering on the edge that you could still be a normal drinker, but now you're coming to me with, like, these certain things, and I'm like, fuck, you're welcome to the group, bud. Yeah. Like, you're with us, you're one of us, like, and that made me, it made me extremely happy that he was opening up and expressing to me what he was feeling, but it made me extremely sad that he's now potentially an addict.
Right.
And that will never really go away.
Yeah.
So it kind of had this thing to it. And I'm, oh, actually, yes. So I live at the Welcome House, and this is my second time being there. The first time I went was in, like, March of this year of 2019. And I lasted a whole maybe 12 hours. Got there in the afternoon. I left by like 5 o'clock in the morning the next day. That was for some a lot of other different reasons, and I kind of freaked the fuck out. And I ran, which is totally my MO, is to run. But when I first got there, this guy and I, we kind of recognized each other, and he came up to me and he was like, yo, like, you're Douglas, right? And I was like, yeah, you're blah. And he's like, yeah. And I was like, what are you doing here? And he's like, oh, I work here. I was like, oh, okay, cool. Like, where have you been? Like, he was this guy that, like, very involved in, like, the skate scene in Kansas City. He was like, I won't give too many details. Right. I'm sure he wouldn't care, but I haven't talked to him about it, so I'm not going to. But yeah, very, very well-known person. And I hadn't seen him around in a long time. And a long time, meaning like a few years. And I was just like, yo, what happened to you? And he's like, well, I came here a few years back and I stopped skating and I've been clean and, you know, I'm happier for it. And I was just blown away, like blown away that he was clean. Didn't realize he had had that big of a problem with it. I knew he definitely came from like a group that are some pretty, I mean, really good skateboarders and very heavy partiers too. I just didn't know necessarily that was, you know, affecting. And from the outside, it didn't seem like it was affecting him badly. But we all know how good we are hiding stuff like that. And then it blew me away for the first time that, like, getting rid of skateboarding in your life could have, like, this positive thing. Mm. And that
fucked. He completely stopped.
He completely, that I know of, he does not skate at all. Which, for some people, that might be better. And I had to, and that was the first time I had ever considered, like, skateboarding was my first love. And, like, just, I really can't see myself not doing it. And I still kind of don't, but that started this kind of adventure I had of where I no longer needed it. I just kind of want it and I like it to be there, but it's not this like, it's not like I don't have like this withdrawal from not getting it.
Right.
It's kind of, I have a little bit of a different relationship with it now. And that was really nice to see. And it was just really good to see him, you know, be clean and be successful and be content and happy with what he was doing. And now he's gotten a different job, so he doesn't work at the Welcome House anymore. But it wasn't for anything. It was just because he's moving on to a bigger, better things that he wants to pursue. It wasn't because he went back out or anything like that. And that was, and like, so I came back and he was still working, but then they were like, oh, he's leaving. And I'm like, wait, what happened? And they're like, oh, no, it's okay. He's just, you know, he's going to do his thing. And I was like, oh, cool. Yes. Like, he's leaving. That's a little sad. He's leaving. Like, I would have liked to be here and be able to talk to him a little more, but like, cool. He's found another job doing what he wants to do. And the more open I am about it, the more the like that type of stuff, like being able to post that on my Facebook and then people like comment on it. That's what made this one friend like kind of reach out to me. He had seen me like go through my last 2 years really close up, but that was the first time he like was reaching out and was like, hey, what's your meetings like? And I know there's a few people and his life that potentially could like use AA and NA help. And I didn't want to like single him out. So I was like, so who are you thinking about? And he was like, I'm thinking of me.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, bingo. I'm really glad like, you know, if you can come to me and like, and stuff like that. And it was that article that, you know, kind of triggered it for him because he knew he could come to me, but it's something about, that was an article all of like this handful of skaters and he's a skater. So it's, and that's what helped me with like the whole Jim Greco thing. It's, and with other people in the skate industry that are now clean, that are pro, we've been watching them since we were little kids and we've idolized them and looked up to them. Like they're like, you know, they're our pro athletes, mm-hmm. like they're our role models or whatever. And in a lot of ways, they're not the best role models. Like some of the companies Jim Greco comes from, like if your mom like were to watch those skate videos, they would be like, you are never skateboarding again. Like they would definitely not be into it. But if you've watched the full circle of like where they've come from, what they did, what they're doing, what they're now at, like you'd be like, I want you to watch this because like this is,
well, I'm glad that you suggested that because it's gotten me to think about it's gotten me to learn a little bit about something I knew nothing about. Absolutely. It got me to know you better. It got me to appreciate just the art of skateboarding. And I've always liked this topic of artist in recovery. I've talked to like a poet and I haven't talked to a musician yet, but I've talked to a poet and a couple of comedians.
Comedy would be really hard. I feel like sober. Mark Maron is a sober comedian. He talks about that. I had a friend get me onto his book and he made a TV show and he does a podcast too.
I should check that out. The comedy thing is really interesting to me. It's cause that's quite an art too, and it's not easy.
It seems really cool, and I like it, and I like to make people laugh. But man, I could not imagine.
But there's quite a few sober comedians out there. They're recovering.
Yeah. He's the first one that comes to mind. My sponsor was actually one. Really?
Yeah. My old sponsor. He was a comedian and still is.
Yeah.
He plays in places like South Dakota.
Hey, everybody needs to laugh. South Dakota. Everybody needs to laugh. Yeah. I think it's really cool to see artists in recovery and just how they tackle it and go about it. And
I like to see them. I like this whole idea that, you know, you're in recovery. You can enjoy your life. You can do things that you like to do. You can do them better.
Yeah.
You know, there's no reason that you shouldn't pursue those things.
No, a lot of people feel like they can't go to shows anymore. They can't go to concerts. And I mean, I haven't been to a whole lot of concerts in general, but people, and it's also not such a big trigger for me to have people drinking around me.
It doesn't
sometimes
bother me.
It's annoying.
It bothers me if they're like out of control drunk.
Yeah.
If they're just sitting around drinking a drink, it doesn't bother me.
It's whatever.
At all. I think nothing of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, I feel like in my face, drunk.
Then it's just, it's more offensive and annoying. And that would have been offensive and annoying to me when I was using it. And I just would have been more prompt to say something about it versus have boundaries and kind of separate myself from it. So I've still had, you know, a lot of enjoyment going to shows and just still having a lot of fun with that.
Yeah.
And same with being around other skateboarders and I just don't go to the after party.
Right.
I'm there for the party at the skate park or the party going through the streets or whatever. But when it gets to the heavy smoke session afterwards or the drink session or whatever, that's when I take my leave and I just really have no business to be there anymore. I don't get anything from it, and I'm not really giving anything to it besides possibly being the guy with a bad attitude at the corner going, look at them. I'm the buzzkill at that point. They're kind of the buzzkill to me. So it's just, you know, I'd just rather not be there. I think it's unfortunate when people think they can't do things that they used to like to do just because they've tainted it with their drug use.
Right.
And sometimes it just takes a while to get that back. It took a while to kind of take skateboarding back for me and to be able to kind of change my relationship with it. But I think it's worth trying. If it really does bring you enjoyment.
I'll tell you something, I stopped when I drank, and I'm glad I stopped it and I'll never do it again. Listening to country music.
Okay. Fair enough.
For whatever reason, probably because I grew up out in the country and everything, in Kansas, and I'd go to these bars where, you know, they have a jukebox and they play country music, and so country music was like the background of my life when I was drinking, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So, but it was kind of fucking depressing music too.
Some country music definitely is.
Now the stuff they call country music now is nothing like the stuff
a lot of pop country and stuff. Yeah,
but I remember when I hit bottom of my drink, it's like I didn't even listen to music for a while, but I definitely wouldn't listen to country music.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember filling out one of my first times in detox, filling out a safety sheet or whatever. And it's like, what are some of your triggers? And I was like, certain music that I have associated with certain people. And then with those people have these certain things attached to it. So yeah, that makes me super depressed.
But I realize I like other music better.
There you go. I'm glad it expanded your music. I love all kinds of music. It's fun switching it up. I can't just get into one genre.
True.
And that's what I like about skateboarding.
I do kind of like bluegrass. I have to admit that.
Do you? Hey. Yeah. I think it's a better version of country.
It is.
Yeah.
All right, man. Well, I enjoyed this. Thank you very much.
Me too. Thanks for having me over. This is a great idea.
It was fun. It was.
I love your podcast. It's
thank you.
It's what brought me to finding We Agnostics. And
that's funny.
I love it. It was so trippy, listening to your podcast, finding the group, then coming into the group. Uh-huh. And then the first time I heard you, I was like, that's the guy, that's him, that's him. So it's
I love doing the podcast.
I think it's such an awesome thing, and I still run into people that don't know what a podcast is.
Isn't that funny?
I'm like, well, it's
you know, before I did
talk this podcast, radio on the internet,
I didn't know anything about them either. Before really? I started doing this one, I was like, I think I actually did a podcast before I actually ever listened to one.
Really?
I was in a podcast with. No, that's probably not true. I used to listen to some atheist podcasts. When I was going through that period when I was realizing I was an atheist, I'd listen to these all the time. There were quite a few of them.
I love them. I do too. Yeah, they're just a great way to gain information and just news and just I don't know, just kind of get into touch with different things.
And they're funny because you have these little niches, you know?
Yeah.
So we have this little niche podcast. It's like atheist. NAA.
Yeah.
AA is a niche, and then you have the other little, even more niche than that. Mm-hmm. So it's, anyway. Thanks again. Appreciate it.
And that's another episode of AA Beyond Belief. Thank you so much for listening. Hey, if you'd like to help out our site and podcast, there's a couple of things you can do. First of all, go over to iTunes and leave us a review, hopefully a favorable one. You can also help out financially with either a recurring or one-time contribution. You can do this by setting up small recurring donations at our Patreon page, which you can find at patreon.com/AABeyondBelief, or through PayPal at paypal.me/AABeyondBelief. And you can always visit our site, aabeyondbelief.org, and click on the Donate button. Thanks again for listening. We'll be back again real soon with another episode of AA Beyond Belief, the podcast.